Okay, so now we're going to talk our last lesson about dot products here. And there is a pretty good explanation of what I'm about to talk about on pages 784 to 787 in your textbook. You do not need to read it first, but if anything I'm saying doesn't make sense, you can look it up there and see if their language is better, because this is one of those lessons that no matter how many times I teach it, I just trip over my words. So hopefully that won't happen this time, but we'll find out. This first stuff is not difficult. I don't think you're going to need to read about it, but this is about direction cosines. So we like to measure direction either using the components of a vector or using angles. And up until now, the only angle we've really used is the angle that something makes with the positive x-axis. And when we move into 3D, I can make angles with the x-axis, the y-axis, or the z-axis. And those angles are called alpha, beta, and gamma, respectively. So if I want to figure out the direction angle of something, it's the angle that a vector in space, this vector v, makes with the x-axis, the y-axis, or the z-axis. Now, the x-axis points in the same direction as vector I, and remember vector I is the vector 1, 0, 0. The y-axis points in the same direction as j, which is 0, 1, 0, and the z-axis the same direction as k, which is 0, 0, 1. So if I want the angle between a vector and an axis, I can do that cosine formula, that dot product cosine formula with I, j. Here it says, what is the component form of I? We already wrote that down. That's 1, 0, 0. And it says, use the formula for cos theta involving dot products to create a formula for calculating alpha. So if I want to calculate the angle between I and V, then cosine alpha is going to be I, that's a terrible I dot V over the magnitude of I times the magnitude of V. And then I'm just going to call vector V, V1, V2, V3. So that's going to be 1, 0, 0. Dotted with V1, V2, V3, divided by the magnitude of I. Well, I is 1, 0, 0. It's a unit vector, so the magnitude of I is 1. And then the magnitude of V, I'm honestly just going to leave as the magnitude of V for now. And if you notice on the top, when I go to do my dot product, my zeros are going to make V2 and V3 disappear, and all I'm going to be left on top is with V1. So cosine alpha is just V1 divided by the magnitude of V. And that's how you can get alpha. So alpha is inverse cosine of V1 divided by the magnitude of V. And then I could do the same exact thing for beta and gamma and say, okay, if I want alpha, it's V, whoops, inverse cos of V1 divided by magnitude of V. Beta is going to be inverse cos V2 divided by the magnitude of V. And gamma, which I always have trouble writing. You think after all these years I'd get good at it, but I'm not there yet. Gamma is going to be inverse cos of V3 divided by the magnitude of V. So it says find the direction angles for the vector W, 4, negative 2, 7. Now I'm going to draw W right now. So when we draw it, how do we draw the X, Y, and Z axes? So Z goes up. If you're in physics, Z points out at you. But in math, we put Z up. Y goes here. And then X is kind of like slanted toward you. And so there's your standard first octant. We're supposed to draw 4, negative 2, 7, so I am going to need the other side of the y-axis here. So I am going to draw a vector that goes out 4 along x, left 2 along y, and up 7 along z. And again, we're sketching this, so it's fine. And there's my vector w. And you don't have to draw these all in because they're probably going to get overlapped, but we're going to try it anyway. This thing right here would be alpha. This thing right here would be beta. and this thing right here would be gamma. Okay, so alpha is inverse cosine of the first component divided by the magnitude of the vector. So that's 16 plus 4 plus 49, which is going to be inverse cos of 4 divided by the square root of 69. And let's see. Inverse cos 4 over root 69. Root 69 is about 8. 4 eighths is about a half. And the inverse cos of a half is about 60 degrees. So I'm thinking we're going to see something near 60. So inverse cos 4 divided by the square root of 69. Make sure I'm doing that right. I'm not. The 6 didn't come through. Look at that. 61.2. So I'm just going to say 61 degrees. We're going to round to the nearest whole degree, all right? So alpha is 61 degrees. And then I'm going to do the rest. So I'm not going to talk through them. I'm just going to do them. You can do them on your own and then check back with my work. See, I said I wasn't going to talk, but I couldn't help myself. Inverse cosine is going to be negative 2 over radical 69, which makes me realize that I did something wrong already. So because I did it wrong, I'm not going to be ashamed. You guys shouldn't be ashamed when you make a mistake. I just made a mistake. Beta is the angle that the vector makes with the positive y-axis, not with the nearest y-axis. Silly goose, Mrs. Vibber. So beta is this thing. And the reason that writing this beta formula out alerted me to that is that I've got a negative on top, which means it makes an obtuse angle, and I realized that the beta I drew was not obtuse. All right, so now I will try to be quiet again. I just can't help myself. I love math so much, I just want to keep talking about it. 104 degrees for beta, and then gamma. And there's our vector angles, our direction angles. Ta-da! Okay, one other thing we can do with vectors, and here comes the part where Mrs. Vibber always trips over her words. I don't know why, it just happens. There is something called a projection, and I know you do something with this in physics. So it's going to be similar, not exactly the same, but very similar if you've taken or are taking physics. So the definition of a projection and vector components, I'm going to read the box and then explain. Let u and v be non-zero vectors. Moreover, let u be w1 plus w2, where w1 is parallel to v and w2 is orthogonal to v, as shown in the figure. W1 is called the projection of u onto v, or the vector component of u along v, and is denoted by w1 equals the projection of u onto v. I said a lot of words. The most important words I said were how you say this out loud. This is called the projection of u onto v. W2 is u minus w1, and that's the vector component of u orthogonal to v. Quick reminder, orthogonal means the same as perpendicular. Okay. What? Here's what that really means. Oh, I made a funny noise, and then it made me yawn. The projection of u onto v is most easily explained using a physics concept. If I am pulling a wagon, okay, so imagine there is a wagon here. If I am pulling a wagon and the handle of the wagon is vector u, when I pull that wagon, if there is a child inside, I will hopefully not be pulling the wagon off the ground with the child inside. Instead, I pull the wagon using the handle, but the direction the wagon moves is along v. So what this really is the projection of u onto v is basically figuring out when you use a force along the direction of U, how much actualized force is applied in the direction of motion. Okay, so that's a physical construct of these this mathematical idea of a projection. So hopefully that works. The projection of U onto V really more has to do with V being important in direction only. And the projection of U onto V, our book is calling W1. Then, because sometimes perpendicularity is important as it relates to, again, physics, where we have like friction or gravity that is pulling straight down, W2 is perpendicular to W1. Okay, so we're just going to do this. If I want to figure out if I pull with U amount of force, but make something move in the direction of V, how much does it actually move or how much force is actualized in that direction? The formula is the projection of U onto V is U dot V divided by the magnitude of V squared times vector V. The only thing I care that you understand about this formula is how to plug stuff into it and get other stuff out of it. And for you to realize, that's supposed to be a highlighter, that this creates a scalar. And then you're multiplying that scalar by vector V. So the projection of U onto V ends up being a new vector in the same direction as V, but with a different magnitude. Okay? Okay. So this example, we're just going to do the example and just use the formula. Find the projection of U onto V and the vector component of U orthogonal to V for the vectors U and V given. So we are going to sketch them out and say, all right, U is this thing, and that's 2, negative 4, 3. V is this thing, 6, 1, negative 9. This is not drawn to scale. Okay. Now I'm going to find the projection of U onto V. And if you're thinking, dear God, Mrs. Vibber, I am never going to remember this formula. Guess what? You don't have to. In Calc 3, I give you all the formulas all the time. On quizzes, on tests, on the final exam, you will have the formula. Because you know what? Nobody memorizes these unless they accidentally do it because they use it a lot. Otherwise, real mathematicians and physicists, they look this crap up. So I'm just going to give it to you. All right, the projection of U onto V. Now let's use the formula. U dot V goes on top. Okay, I know how to do dot products. 12 minus 4 minus 27. That goes on top. Over the magnitude of V squared. Well, the magnitude of V squared is really just the components of V squared and added together. So that's going to be 6 squared plus 1 squared plus 9 squared. And then I'm going to multiply all of this by vector V, 6, 1, negative 9. And so really that's going to be 2 minus 4 is negative 2, minus 27 is negative 29. And then on the bottom here I have 81, 82 plus 36 is 118. So what I've learned from this is because I end up negating vector V, okay, I take vector V and that lead coefficient becomes negative, this ends up being parallel to V, but technically in the opposite direction. So what I'm realizing is vector V is here, and I could have slash should have drawn vector U going this way, because when I project U onto V, it ends up looking like that. Another way to think about projections, the projection of U onto V is the shadow that you would make on vector V. That's another interesting way to look at it. So there's the projection of U onto V. And then it says find the vector component of U orthogonal to V for the vectors U and V. So really that orthogonal component is this vector up here, where this blue dotted vector added to this green vector equals U. And in your book, they call this W-2 and this W-1. So for consistency's sake, I'm going to call it that. So I just created W-1. And then based on the picture, W-1 plus W-2 equals U. Okay, so your projection plus the orthogonal component gives you vector U. So if I want to find W-2 now, it would be U minus W-1, which is U minus the projection. And so that's going to be 2, -4, 3 minus -29, 118, 6, -1, -9. Ugh, garbage. And then I get something else. I don't want to do this. So 2, technically this is going to be minus a negative, so I'm going to make it plus. So 2 plus 29 over 118 times 6. 2 plus 29 over 118 times 6. 3.47, I'm just going to call it 3.5. And then -4 plus 29 1/18ths. -3.75, so I'm just going to go -3.8. And 3 minus 9 times 29 1/18ths. Where is this? 3 minus 9 times 29. 0.78, so I'm going to call that 0.8. We don't use that one that much, but it exists, so I wanted to make sure I explained it to you. I am sure in a physics context it would be more important. So that is what we have going for us right now. Sorry about that. Somebody walked into my room right before I was ready for the joke. So, joke of the day is, what do zombie vegans eat for breakfast? Grains! So mad. But the voice made it funny, right? All right, I'm done. Have a great day, everybody.